Mr. Rubinstein, isn't it rather paradoxical that every wunderkind makes his orchestral debut playing one of the Mozart concerti as though they were child's play? That's hardly the case, though, is it?
Well, Mozart, the case of Mozart is a very strange one. You said, you put right away, you know, the thing in the nutshell, you know, because it is true that one plays Mozart mainly in the beginning of one's career, as a wunderkind, or I mean as a young boy, in any case, even if one doesn't use the public for it. And then at the end of one's artistic life, one comes back with all the heart to Mozart. This is absolutely true. But I can explain that very well. You see, Mozart is so utterly pure, so utterly devoid of any exterior element to help his inspiration. Because even Beethoven, who was certainly a very deep mind and wonderful genius, great musician and so on, needed a lot of help. He needed a lot of I wouldn't say artificial things, but what all those long pauses, you know, those fermatas, as he called it, you know, I mean, Mozart never used any of it. It was always flowing, it was always simple and so on. So you see what happens, a young, innocent mind of a born musician, of course, plays Mozart straight away, you know, straight. I am not quite sure if I didn't play an andante of Mozart's A major concerto more, I don't know, close to the spirit of Mozart when I was 8 or 10 years old than when I'm now. Because now I can't help myself to try to become simple, you understand?
Yes, yes.
And that, of course, at once is a little fabricated. I try to be simple. This is a very bad thing to say. You know, I ought to be simple. You see, I was simple, certainly. When I was 10, I couldn't conceive any other way of performing that thing. Well, now, hundreds of different ways of performing. I try them even out. I try to change tempi and things like that. You see?
Yes.
It's a very, very great difference. But then I'll tell you another thing. Oh, well, there's a lovely answer which Schnabel had for Mozart. Don't you know it?
No, I don't think I've ever heard it.
Somebody asked Schnabel, well, maestro, why don't you play more Mozart sonatas in concerts? He said, you see, Mozart sonatas are so easy for children, but so difficult for artists.
There it is in a nutshell again. I don't imagine you remember, or do you, the very first time you played any Mozart in public. Let me ask you this. Do you remember the first Mozart concerto you played in public?
But of course.
You
it
do.
It was the A major concerto, number Köchel, you know, 488, which I played. Joachim, you see, the great Joachim, was going to perform it with me. That was, of course, a fantastic honor for me, you know, in public. And my personal professor, you see, Professor Bart, my music professor, my piano professor, you see, wanted to have me try it out. So actually the very first performance didn't take place with Joachim, but in Potsdam, near Berlin, with a little orchestra conducted by my harmony teacher, Mr. Kuhlenkampf, the father of the violinist Kuhlenkampf, who was not very well known in this country, but was a prominent German violinist. So that was actually the very first time I played that concerto.
Do you remember the attitude with which you approached it?
Not only I remember, but you see, my future readers, I'm writing just now my memoirs, will read a very, very important description of the whole event. This and the further concerts, you know, with Joachim and so on and so forth.
Yes, you don't want to scoop yourself now.
But this Mozart concerto became a sort of repertoire piece for about 2 or 3 years. I played it very much. But then I became an unbearably young fellow, you know, filled with Tchaikovsky, with all that sort of stuff, you know. And so the managers, of course, wanted me to bang it out. It was the Tchaikovsky concerto, Saint-Saëns concerto, and all sort of flashy pieces. So they wouldn't have any Mozart. It wasn't my fault so much. I wanted to play Mozart. They said, oh, you know, the public would prefer to, why don't you play the Saint-Saëns? You know, they were always a little bit after that. I can tell you a lovely anecdote from Portland of the 1920s.
Portland Maine,
Oregon,
or Oregon?
Oregon.
Yes.
I had there quite a good success as a soloist. And so the orchestra wanted me again for the next season. And we discussed the program, and we decided to play the fourth Beethoven concerto, certainly a beautiful piece of music, G major concerto. Everything went fine. 2 weeks before the concert, I received a telegram from Portland. The committee of the Symphony Association would be so grateful if you changed the Beethoven into a concerto of Rubinstein, Anton Rubinstein. Well, I smelled at once what's all about. You see, of course, Rubinstein plays Rubinstein and so on. Some people might come thinking it was my concerto and what not and so on. And thing. Well, I was so furious that I answered, "Can't you call me Beethoven for that occasion?"
I think that situation prevails even today. That is, managers tend sometimes to underestimate the potential tastes of the various audiences. I'm sure you find that even today.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, I must tell you about Italy, the most musical country after all, the birthplace of music, of the art of music. We all know that, you know. Well, Italy, about 20 years ago, wouldn't have any Mozart. You know, all the cities, whenever I offered to play something of Mozart, were at once making faces.
Yes.
No, Mozart, not so much. You know, the public doesn't like it so much.
Well, fortunately, you know, that seems to have changed.
Yes. Beethoven had a much better stand, you know, because he was a sort of an imposing fellow, you know. He was a Prometheus. He was a threatening fellow, you know. Mm-hmm. And anybody would object to any Beethoven, he said, ta-ta-ta-ta. See? That did it.
The Mozart A major concerto, which you said figured as the first bit of Mozart, we have known through the years, through your RCA Victor recordings of it, at various stages in your career. And now, of course, in this collection of the five Mozart concerti, here you are playing it. Do you consider that this performance is perhaps a summation of your views of the piece?
Look here, there is a very disagreeable answer I have to give you, both for myself, for the Victor Company, and for all concerned. I adore every new record which I accept, you know, which I pass, because I have the right not to pass it if I don't think it's good enough. But I'm so enthusiastic about the new record that I try to have always a public to listen to it, you know. It's not very easy to get them. You see, I'm offering even prizes for it, you know. I'm ready to give $5 an hour for listening
really?
To the record. Because my family is always busy and everybody, you know how they are, you know. Oh, not now, to Daddy, you know, tomorrow might be, and so on. So I'm frustrated.
I'm available the next time you're in that situation.
Thank you
Mr.
very
Rubinstein.
Much. I will Fine. Profit by that. See, I love it. Sometimes a visitor comes just to ask me what weather, you know, what time it is. I said, oh, don't you want to listen to a new record? You see, but all that told, after 3 or 4 or 5 months, I'm ready to make a new record because I advance, I change. There's something in me which wants something different about that same piece, and the record never changes, you see? And there is a divorce. There is not one single record which I really accept wholeheartedly after a year. Not one single. You see, those Mozarts, of course, I adore them just now. But I'm perfectly sure that in about half a year, I would like to play them again. You see, I apply that to everything in life. You see, I don't like people who stick pedantically to an opinion having been said 10 years ago. You know mm-hmm. how sometimes people try to pin you down? Even interviewers on television, I've seen one of those hard fellows, you know, who interview people with old magazines or old articles in their hands and said, "Weren't you saying one day that you liked Brahms better than Beethoven?" And you say, "Oh yes, I was such a fool 10 years ago, but I changed 9 years ago." Another opinion, you know, I mean, but they will not take that. You see, they like to pin you down, you see, and that is nonsensical. You know that I don't like to write letters. I mean, I will send a telegram or a letter about a thing like meeting you tomorrow, or I will send you this thing, or I will, you know, something absolutely normal, something simple. But expressing opinions or feelings or something like that in a letter, is for me extremely difficult, because once put the envelope into a mailbox, you know, I change right away the whole opinion about the whole thing. I said, why did I write that? I don't feel it at all just now. You see?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because I'm thinking forward. I'm thinking ahead. I'm trying to change. I'm getting new ideas. I see there's another world around me right away, in an hour, tomorrow morning. You understand?
One must
be able to do that, not stick just for the pedantic reason. Oh, I said that, I must stick to it, you see now.
Mm-hmm.
This is my eternal opinion. This is a nonsensical thing. And musically, it is criminal.
One of the things I find intriguing about this collection of Mozart concerti is the fact that there are some of the concerti included in the album, which you, as far as I know, have never played in public. For example, have you ever played the D minor in public?
No.
No.
No. I'll tell you, I'm very shy about my playing Mozart because there's a little weakness, might be a little vanity, you know. There are so many pianists who are labeled by the public or by critics. Oh, he's a Beethoven player, he's a Chopin player, he's a Mozart player. You see, I was always having the eyebrows raised when I pronounced the name Mozart. I said, what? Are you playing Mozart? Really? Oh,
yes.
Because I know two or three pianists, I don't want to name them exactly, who are the famous Mozart performers. Well, my Mozart has another approach, you see. I feel Mozart just as I feel Chopin. I feel him a warm-hearted, full-blooded musician and not a Baroque composer, you understand? And I feel that he's treated a little bit, you know, with red soles to their shoes, you know, with a little wig. You know, all the attitudes of the time, but not the heart. And I think that is wrong. I am against it, you see. Therefore, I was a little shy about my playing. And I didn't want to have the public say, oh, well, he thinks he's playing Chopin, something like that. Therefore, I keep it to myself. But on recordings, of course, it's a joy to make it. There is no public around to deride me or to go against me, you see.
Of course, there's the broad public around the world, which falls
heir
to your performances.
Well, I don't see them. I don't see them.
Yes.
They can do what they like to me, see. As a matter of fact, I'm sometimes self-conscious about that. When I make a difficult recording, I visualize absolutely clearly a man who tried to shave in the morning in Australia and says to his valet or to his servant or to somebody, put a Rubinstein record on. And then while shaving, he says, my goodness, throw it away. This is just absolutely horrible. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So I feel right away I must play well enough to please a fellow who shaves in Australia in the morning in a bad humor.
In the Mozart concerti, there are openings where Mozart apparently intended for the soloist to improvise little cadenzas. I notice that sometimes you do improvise cadenzas and sometimes you don't. I'd like to ask you about your attitude toward this.
And my attitude is very simple. You see, when Mozart found it necessary to write his own cadenzas or his own little preludes or something, which he did to quite a few concertos, you know that.
Yes.
Not to all, but quite a few, about 12, I would say, or something like that. I have the full volume of it. Then, of course, I feel a tremendous respect for Mozart, even greater than for Beethoven. I would attempt sometimes to play another cadenza than Beethoven's own. I used to play a very brilliant Saint-Saëns cadenza even for the G major concerto because it was much more effective and much shorter and to the point. You know, Beethoven sometimes overlapped a little bit in his cadenzas. But in Mozart's case, never. You see, he never overlapped. He never exaggerated anything. So I'm sticking to his cadenzas. Well, in one instance I used Hummel's cadenza and interferences, you know, in the C minor, because Hummel was a pupil of Mozart and he had respect, and he was a sort of, for me, a link between Mozart and Chopin. I have a great feeling for Hummel. He is now out of fashion, nobody knows much about him, but he was a great teacher for Chopin. He taught him lots of things about the piano and how to treat it. and he learned himself a lot from Mozart.
Let me just interject a question here. Do you ever play any Hummel concerti these days?
No.
Too bad. There's one in A
minor. I played two or three when I was quite young. I played it. Oh, yes, I played it. I did play it, even in public, Hummel. I always was fond of Hummel. But he's out of fashion.
Unfortunately.
We passed that time. There you are. You see, we are better than that. There you are. It is always this choosing question. See, we always think now in terms, there were only a few composers in old times. We forget there were just as many as now. And even those we don't know are much more successful than the ones we worship nowadays.
In their own time.
Well, of course, Mozart had nothing but Italian rivals who have no name today. But he was full of them. He was writing all the time to his sister. There was such and such and such spaghettini and whatnot, macaroni. With a colossal success with his opera or symphony or whatever it was.
Of course, Mozart's concerti, many of them were composed specifically for the composer's own use as a concert virtuoso.
Well, and the poor darling, you know, he couldn't even write out his piano voice. He had no time for it, so that also accounts a lot for his improvising. Because he had to write it in later. And then, of course, he forgot a little bit what he was doing at the time. And he left certain freedom. Only, you see, we are now much more shy and more afraid of the public, more responsible, and also through the radio and gramophone records and so on, very exposed. You see, don't forget that about 40, 50 years ago, we had the concert field all to ourselves. Nobody knew much about us, you see. When you left a big capital for the provinces, well, you could impose on them whatever you wanted. You could play with your foot, and they would find it marvelous because they didn't hear better, you see. But now everybody in Congo or in Alaska or on St. Helena Island, you know, hears Toscanini conduct and, you know, the best fellows play, and they know all about it. You can't trick them anymore.
That's an interesting aspect of the concert routine. You're always, in a sense, competing, well, not only with your colleagues, but with yourself. Your own recorded performances, your own broadcasts, wherever they may come from, precede you, and in a sense, you're always competing with Arthur Rubinstein wherever you play.
Not only, but with many others, too. You see, it is a tremendous competition, and with a very well-understood public. I mean, public who understands and heard a lot. And is not being fooled at all by anything. They hear all the wrong notes now and so on, you know. But in old times, they thought everything acceptable. And don't forget, in the times of Beethoven, even up to Chopin and then Schumann and so on, Liszt, they gave concerts of abominable programs. I don't know if you sometimes read programs.
Yes, I've seen some of them.
Unbelievable programs. You wouldn't dare to produce it anywhere now. Mm. And then, to top it all, to get the real applause of the gallery, they finished by an improvisation. They sometimes asked even the public for a theme, to improvise upon that theme, you see. Well, nobody would risk it now. We might be even better than they were. We came to it. We like to improvise too. Mm-hmm. I sometimes improvise with great pleasure. My children come in, sometimes, whose work was it, Daddy? What did you play just now? I said, nothing, I was just fooling. Oh, it sounded so... Well, we would never risk to do that in front of an audience. But those times it was absolutely accepted, you see? All that has changed a great deal.
Mr. Rubinstein, I'd like to come back to something that we touched upon a while ago, and that's the question of the typing of pianists. This pianist is a Mozart pianist, that one is a Chopin pianist, and so forth. I think you, in your own career, have gone through various stages of typing. At one time, you were a Chopin player, at another time, a Tchaikovsky player, and so forth. I think at this point, you're a piano player of the entire musical repertoire.
Well, I was always a sort of a chameleon, musically speaking, you know, all my life. You see, I led even a terrible double life when I was a youngster, because I had that German teacher, Professor Heinrich Barth, who was pedantic, was an excellent musician in his own little line, you know, and he was belonging to the Mendelssohn, Schumann, Brahms school, very much influenced by Joachim's personality at the Academy, you know, of music those times. And for him, Wagner, Berlioz, Liszt was taboo. Hmm. You see, they were criminals. They were their adversaries. They were the, you know, you couldn't touch them. He prohibited me to hear a Wagner opera in those times. Well, what happened? At the age of 12, I had to prepare for him a Mendelssohn Capriccio. Instead of that, I played through the whole Meistersinger piano score, you know.
For him?
No.
Oh, I shouldn't think so.
At home, that's what I'm
yes,
doing.
Yes.
I led a double life, mm-hmm. you know. I played Strauss, you know, all the poems, symphony, you know, symphonic poems of Strauss by heart at that time, you know. When Salome appeared of Strauss, for 500 francs lately in Paris, I played the whole score by heart to people, private people, who were ready to pay me 500 francs for it, you see. Hmm. They said there was a libretto, and I played the whole thing through, from beginning to end. So you see, this was the kind of life I was leading. The one part, you know, the official life. I went to him, the Mendelssohns. I played a lot of Mendelssohn, but I didn't like it so frightfully much those times. I did love Schumann. Chopin was for me still a closed book. I was very much in love with Brahms. From the beginning, it had never changed. From the age of 10, I don't think I ever lost my love for Brahms. And of course, Mozart was my bread and butter, you understand? I mean, that was the base of my life then. I played, when I went to friends' houses, for instance, I played for them, I read for them endless concerto sonatas of Mozart. That was the great pleasure of doing, you see? But as I tell you, I knew all the modern music of my time right away, and I was wildly interested, while my professor ignored even that I knew the first word of it, you see? Well, that proves to you, see, I could play really all the schools right away and always. You know, when I did play Saint-Saëns or Tchaikovsky, if you asked me to play for you a Mozart concerto, I would have tears in my eyes with pleasure, you see. Chopin, I met later through a friend of mine who revealed to me the real Polish Mozart, the Chopin, the real one. I was then about 16, not before.
What is the real Polish Chopin, Mr. Rubinstein?
The Polish Chopin is one which was ill-treated for a long, long time, and I must say, with great dismay, chiefly by Paderewski, you see. For personal reasons, for personal exploitation, for reasons of having more success with the public and so on, people exaggerate to such an extent the natural lyricism of Chopin, the natural flow, the natural beauty of melody and so on, instead of playing it straightforward, simply, with feeling, inside feeling, you see, they let go, you see, they raise their fingers for half an hour, lingered over notes which one shouldn't, broke the chords, you know, broke the thing, waited for half an hour and there was a little suspense, you know, I mean, all that was started really by Paderewski. And of course, people were absolutely fainting with pleasure. They thought that was the last word. And that was followed, as tradition, by very many pianists up till now. I was the first to fight for the straight Mozartian Chopin. And mind you, I was heavily attacked in my dear Poland. The Polish critics and Polish public said, yes, Rubinstein plays, has lots of talent, but his Chopin is absolutely dry. Because I didn't give way to all those things. You see, I tried to get the music straight. It doesn't need anything. What Chopin has written into the music is good enough.
One other topic I'd like to cover during our conversation, Mr. Rubinstein. There was a time in the 1920s, 30s, when you were really in the front rank of champions of the music of the contemporary literature. You brought Villa-Lobos to Paris to bring him to international attention. You played many of the piano pieces of Manuel de Falla, Stravinsky, so that this aspect of the piano repertoire is as much a part of your everyday being
well,
as any other part.
Well, Prokofiev, Shostakovich, sure. I played them all, Scriabin, Szymanowski, you know, all the great, really, and what not, I mean,
yes.
Debussy and Ravel, you know, I played Debussy in Warsaw in 1904. It's hard to believe, the first pieces. Jardin sous la pluie, I played in 1904 in Warsaw, and they told me that it was a mad sort of thing and shouldn't play such thrash.
Yes. Tell us a story about Shostakovich and your father-in-law, which I've heard before and which I find absolutely intriguing.
Oh, that's a very curious thing, you see. I mean, I couldn't tell you exactly the year, but there was some 26 or 7, I would say. And Shostakovich came to Warsaw as a pianist for the Chopin competition. You know, in Warsaw they gave every 3 years a Chopin competition. They still do it now. I think every 5 years, if I'm not mistaken. Chopin competition where the candidates, you know, for the prizes must play nothing but Chopin. And of course Shostakovich was not the pianist he ought to be for that. So he didn't win a prize. He didn't win a prize. Which was won by Oborin, a very excellent Russian pianist who plays now even with Oistrakh sonatas and so on. He's still there. But Shostakovich showed a personality a little superior to the others. So my father-in-law was the director of the conservatory and of the opera and a great musician, great conductor and so on. Had all those fellows, of course, at his home and was vastly interested. He was the president of the jury. So he got to talk with Shostakovich. He said, well, you seem so interesting. You should have won something, but I see that you didn't practice. You know, oh, well, I couldn't practice because I was very busy on my symphony. So he was then 20 or 21, and my father-in-law went for him. I said, look here, young man, I mean, if you go for a competition for Chopin, it had to be worked out better. I mean, symphony, you could postpone that work, you know. By the way, have you your symphony here? He said, oh yes, I'm still working on it very much. And he showed his first symphony. My father-in-law almost fell on the floor. He said, well, this is a piece of genius. This is colossal. That is tremendous. Stop playing the piano, right? Well, I think Shostakovich took the advice even without listening to my father-in-law. But I mean, my father-in-law was one of the voices in any case.
Yes, yes. Mr. Rubinstein, we're recording our conversation in Manhattan Center in New York, where you do so much of your American recording. You, in a sense, anticipated what I was going to ask earlier when we spoke about recordings, but let me put to you the question directly. Do you enjoy making records? And if you do, tell us why. You've already told us one of the negative aspects of making records.
Oh, no, I beg your pardon. I think that's a misunderstanding. No. The negative aspect of it is simply that a record remains what it is, and I do not remain, fortunately, of course.
Right.
But nevertheless, it makes a certain break between us, you see, but after a long time. I told you that the first issue of a record, first of all, I'm deeply gratified and grateful to the record to be a good professor. I invariably play better a piece which I have recorded than before, because I'm much more conscious of all my faults, all my defects, all the things which were missing. When I listen to myself objectively, because while we are playing, we never listen objectively. We are too much involved in the performance, you understand?
Yes.
So you see, that's it. But I actually physically adore making records. And I think my collaborators, Mr. Wilcox, might be a witness to that I never get really tired of making records. I'm probably the one who gets less tired than any one of my collaborators, you know. I proved it to myself very often. I could go on with an orchestra sometimes a whole night. You know, we start a record at 12 at night, and at 6 in the morning, I'm the only one who really would like to go on till next midnight, you know, if we could. We had the money to pay the orchestra.
Do you have any secret magic that you can impart to those of us who are mortal, who don't have these tremendous physical powers of stamina and resourcefulness?
Oh, it is not physical. It is more moral. It is more moral. You see, I discovered a funny thing in my life. I had, like everybody else, nasty colds and the nose runnings and coughings and headaches and toothaches and God knows what and all the disagreeable things humanity is afflicted with, you see. But when there is a concert, I never have given up a concert. Never. I gave them all. I have never upset a concert or postponed or something like that. So at the concert, for the 2 hours of the duration of the concert, my nose stops running, I stop coughing, there is no headache I'm conscious of, there's nothing at all. Right away after the concert, it begins
again.
It comes back again. So I believe in a certain moral force, a certain thing which is much superior to any physical shortcomings, you see. And at my recordings too, I'm excited, you see, I'm terribly excited. So I'm going on, going on. Sometimes I arrive already very tired in the morning. Well, this morning I arrived half dead. I had a second shot for typhoid yesterday. And it gave me fever. I slept very badly last night. I have such pains that I can hardly walk. I walk lamely.
Yes, I noticed you were
limping. And yet I thought I would come and say, no, gentlemen, I really am incapable of doing anything. Well, I did pretty good work. Not worse than I would expect, I mean, in normal times. You understand? I mean, it doesn't really affect me at all the minute I'm really at it.
Is this
I would give a concert tonight. I could give it, certainly.
Is this a kind of conscious discipline that you have evolved over the years, or has it just happened?
It just happened.
Yes.
I always had that. You see, I'm always tired before a concert. Tired. Sleepy. I'm yawning frightfully, you know. I feel all my bones hurting me, aching me. I'm not sure of my fingers. My head swims. I'm sitting around. I don't know what to do with my time. I tried everything out. I thought, oh, it might be very good to eat a huge beefsteak, you know, for lunch before a concert, or go for a long walk, or talk to people, or not to talk to people, or lie down, or not to lie down, read a book, or not read a book. It was absolute nonsense, you know. I sometimes made the most marvelous resting business, you know, thing, and keeping bed and you know, keeping myself away from people and waiting for the moment of the concert. The concert arrived and I was not inspired a bit. It was something very simple. Sometimes I arrived by a horrible plane at 6 a.m, tired out, exhausted. They called me on the telephone, they irritated me. I got a nasty telegram from someone and so on. The best concert of my life.
One of those imponderables.
Yes. You see, because that has nothing to do with anything.
Mr. Rubinstein, I've enjoyed our conversation immensely. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.